Harish, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, thank you. Can I start sharing my presentation, sir?
Yes, please.
Just a second, sir. Is the slide visible, sir?
No, sir. It is not visible, sir. Screen is not shared. Now it's okay, sir. Yes, you can read. Yes, sir.
Very good evening to all of you, and thank you for the introduction, sir. Today, my focus, as sir has pointed out, one of the research interests will be on the grid interactive building energy systems. Why we are focusing more on the grid interactive building energy systems is because energy efficient buildings, be it a design or rooftop solar PV or building integrated photovoltaic PV buildings, which comes under the concept of zero energy buildings, have been there since last decade. It's not a novel concept, it has been there. When we talk about buildings, the energy usage, especially the electrical energy usage, one thing that we try to look upon is the on-site energy generation, and primarily focusing on the renewable energy generation as the on-site energy. Apart from that, we have energy storage that can be in the form of battery, that is battery energy storage. It can be in the form of compressed air energy storage, and it also can be in the form of thermal energy storage. Majorly, it is being in the form of thermal energy storage. If we are not looking without any major focus on to the on-site renewable energy generation. And battery comes into the picture when we talk about on-site renewable energy generation, majorly through solar PV systems. Now, what has happened is that it has been so independently been worked upon that under a smart grid scenario, it is necessary that how a particular building, be it zero energy or not, be it a normal building, be it having an energy efficient design or not, how does it interact with the electrical power grid under the smart grid scenario? So that will be one of the major focus of the talk that I will be that we will be discussing for the next hour or so. So let us first look into why we have taken building for the talk. Why is it necessary for you to understand and attend this talk, and what is the background motivation about it? Then whenever whatever things that come across whenever we talk about building is green building, energy efficient building, smart building, zero energy building. All four of them I will define with the technical definitions, and we will do a what we call it as comprehensive difference between all these things, and then we will look into where do we stand under a smart grid scenario. Then we will look for net zero energy buildings. What do we mean by zero energy buildings? How can we design a zero energy building? How do we achieve a zero energy building? So on and so forth. Having done all of this, the major topic we'll then cover is the grid interactive building energy systems. We will be looking into how we can develop a building energy system and how does it interact with the grid? What are the flexibility issues? Is there any stability issues? What are the power system dynamics and control? So on and so forth. Though we will discuss simulation results here as well, but we will also look into, if the time persists, the interaction and the simulation results for the paper which is under review, and I will try to present before you. So let us first look into the building energy consumption trends, what we are looking forward to. If you can see here, in the y-axis you have a percentage change in that particular magnitude. For example, red color line will show percentage change in floor area. The orange color will be percentage change in population, energy and emissions. As you can see, for the last decade or so, the floor area has been increasing so very much. As we can see here, the floor area has been increasing since last decade, whereas there has been a steady increase in the population as well. Reason, because there has been an increased standard of living as well. Though ideally we would feel that the population growth and the floor area growth should be matching with each other, but if you can see the difference here, it has been growing, right? Because of increased urbanization, increased standard of living. And the floor area which you are seeing on your screen does not only include the horizontal floor area, but also takes into consideration the vertical floor area. And if we, and now that we have understood that buildings and construction sector through floor area with an increase in population has been an enormous increase, dwelling inside the buildings as a service sector, because 2016-14 buildings was not regarded as a service sector. Now it has been regarded as a service sector by Niti Aayog, because it's in its draft National Energy Policy 2016, they have regarded buildings as a service sector. So they have a dedicated analysis how much energy, electricity it can consume and what is the potential for the savings of energy over there and what can be the different control strategies. If we look into globally, buildings, there is one request from the participants that while during the course of the presentation, if any one of you have any doubts, I would request you to interrupt me then and there, and then I can address the questions also. If it is possible, it's okay. You can interrupt me then and there, and we can have a discussion on it also. Not a problem at all.
Sir, to avoid disturbance during the lecture, actually we mute all the participants. But we
have muted all the participants.
Yes, but we have spared 10 to 15 minutes for question answer session at the end of this session.
Acha. Okay. Okay, sir. Fine, sir. Thank you. Now, if you see the building sector final energy use, which you are seeing on your screen, the y-axis gives the final energy use in exajoules and the x-axis is again the timeline for the decade. If you see the graph, you can see that the electricity plays a very vital role, very major role out of final energy usage. This is for the fuel type. And if you look by end use, the services, fuel type means the final energy use out of that energy, which of the energy has been of the major use or major consuming that has come electricity. And if we talk about by end use, you can see that which of the services in the buildings as a sector consume more of an electricity. if you can see, and this is a global figure, what you are seeing on your screen is coming from the International Energy Agency's report, IEA's report. It's a Paris-based intergovernmental organization. If you see here, you can say that space heating, cooling, and lighting has been one of the major services that demand electricity within the buildings. That means, if I could say in other words, the heating, ventilation, air conditioning systems, lighting systems have been majorly responsible for a huge number or a large number or a large chunk, large major portion of the total energy consumption or usage by buildings. Of course, depending upon the other buildings, we have motors as well. If they are large buildings, because they use elevators, and we develop speed control and the control system for those elevators also, which demand electricity. But that is usually for high tower buildings. Nevertheless, usually for the building energy systems, globally, we can see that HVAC systems and lighting systems have been majorly predominant whenever we speak about the energy usage in the building. Whatever we have seen up till now is the global figure. Let us now come to our country, India, and let us look at the Indian figure. If you see the sector-wise percentage of energy demand, as per the ECBC's Energy Consumption Building Code report, buildings consume around 1/3 of the total energy demand of all the sectors taken into consideration. Inside the building, you have residential building consumption of 24%. Commercial building consumption of 9% and other unaccounted building energy consumption of 67%. This is also again one of the major research gap that people are right now working on the data collection, availability, processing and accumulation of the building energy usage in order to develop statistics, which is true kyunki officially hi building ko kabhi mana nahi gaya ki wo ek service sector hai. Because whenever there is no recognition or though no official thing coming out of it, you cannot generate data, you cannot put your time, money and efforts in order to recognize that, because you won't be having the funding, right? Now that it has now been recognized officially as a sector, a large number of research and also like the capacity building programs, like I want to congratulate Professor Alpesh Patel and the whole department that they have included not only for talking about renewable energy, not only the resources, but also the demand and the system itself. Then only you can say that you have worked for a renewable energy system, right? So the capacity building is happening round the clock, and it is being developing more hugely also. Now, if we look into the electricity demand in the building, the same report forecasted, estimated what will happen 10 years after and what will happen 15 years after. As you can see, there has been an exponentially increase in the electricity demand, and it will cross 1000 terawatt hour per annual electricity consumption or demand by 2030. Right? That it will cross 1000 terawatt hour. Right now we are somewhat close to 480 to 500 terawatt hour. Within 10 years we will double it, we will be able to double it, right? So there is an exponentially increasing pattern whenever we talk about the electricity demand in the building. For the Indian scenario also, what we looked for the global scenario, the services which cause electricity consumption in a building sector, even in the Indian scenario, if you look for residential or commercial buildings, for residential buildings, if you take into consideration air conditioners, coolers, fans and lights, you can say that around more than 60% of the electricity demand is for space heating, space cooling and lighting purpose. Space means building space, the space that we are in right now. If we talk about the commercial buildings, you can see that heating, ventilation, air conditioning system and lighting system both together account for 70% of the 70 to 80% of the total electricity usage inside a commercial building. during COVID scenario, the buildings as a sector, huge interest came in because we can never be locked down to our homes always. Second thing, there will be some time where everything will have to come back to the normal, but we have to be ready with certain strategies where we will not be going through a domino effect and going back to that COVID scenario. So it became very imperative that if you are inside a building space which is public in nature, or people from other communities come over there. When I say community, that means home, not a social caste based, but I'm talking about someone who's not belong, who does not belong to my home. For example, if I go to office, if I go to some commercial mall, if I go to a gym, if I go to a library, or if I go to a shopping complex, whatever it may be. My air conditioner should work in such a way that the chances of virus transmission inside that space should be reduced, should be lesser. What does that mean? That means the CO2 concentration that I'm exhaling has to be replaced as quickly as possible from the fresh air which the air conditioner system will be putting in. That means the mass flow rate will be changing, the sensor mechanism will be changing, so the set point ratings will be changing. Maybe in the coming years, few of air conditioners, maybe residential also, may be developed where through remote control, we will not only be controlling only the temperature through thermostat, but also the CO2 concentration inside the building space, maybe, right? So the graph which you are seeing on your screen shows which of the pollutant, that is particulate matter 2.5 emission, accounts for 54% for the buildings. This is about the air pollutants. That means indoor air quality. We don't talk about outdoor air quality whenever we talk about the building energy. We talk about the indoor air quality. You may ask, ki, sir, energy and air quality mein kya difference hai, kya relation hai? Whenever you talk about air quality, you know, you want to have a good ventilation, and that good ventilation will come from a device or an equipment which is consuming electricity. That can be an air conditioner or a fan, unless and until it is a 100% naturally ventilated building, right? Hence, indoor air quality also affects the energy consumption of your building energy system. Now, let us first understand what building energy system is. Building energy system can be a system, a process, a plant, or a combination of them that asks for energy consumption or energy usage for delivering a particular type of service. That service can be just a shelter, right? That means just to provide a shelter, you require some roof or ceiling, four walls, and a floor. That is also a building energy system, right? Or they may provide you thermal comfort, that is your fan. They may provide you thermal comfort as well as indoor air quality, that can be your air conditioner. Visual comfort, that can be your lighting systems. Acoustic comfort, that can be some other thing, so on and so forth. So each and everything which can be a process or an equipment of a machinery can be regarded as a building energy system. Up till now, what we have established is, first, that buildings as a sector, account for 1/3 of the total energy use. Not only this, because of this 1/3 of total energy use, it also accounts for 25 to 30% of the total greenhouse gas emission. Total means I will be taking into consideration the direct greenhouse gas emission and also the indirect greenhouse gas emission. I hope there has been a discussion on greenhouse gas emission. I hope all of you understand direct greenhouse gas emission or indirect greenhouse gas emission. direct greenhouse gas emission means that there is something, an activity which is happening, and that activity is contributing directly to emission of a gas which is regarded as greenhouse gas. So that particular activity will lead to a direct greenhouse gas emission. For example, if you are riding a motorbike and the tailpipe emissions coming out will come under direct greenhouse gas emissions. Indirect greenhouse gas emission will be in order to have the working or operation of a particular process, in order to develop that, what are the green, what are the activities that you have taken into consideration, which will lead to greenhouse gas emissions, are called as indirect greenhouse gas emission. For example, okay, renewable ki taraf se hi baat karte hain. For example, you need to develop a large wind farm. If you need to develop a large wind farm, you know that you need a large wind turbines in order to develop, in order to install there. Now you have to transport your heavy machinery up till the site. The transportation which you will be using will be majorly driven through gasoline based, oil based or petroleum based products, petroleum based fuels, sorry, not products, fuels. That means the construction of that particular wind plant may tend to indirectly emit the greenhouse gas emission. So that is indirect greenhouse gas emission. Second thing that we have established is that HVAC and lighting systems have been the major contributor for the building energy consumption, right? Now, with these two facts established, let us now look what do we understand by green buildings or smart buildings. Several definitions exist for green buildings. Whatever definitions I will provide you in this presentation will all be from genuine reports, but not any open source definitions. That can be open source, but will be coming from the genuine agencies, legit agencies. If we look up to the US Green Building Council, they define green building as a holistic concept that starts with the understanding that the built environment can have profound effects, that is negative or positive, on the natural environment as well as people inhabiting the buildings every day. Holistic concept means it's an umbrella based concept. Built environment means not only building. For example, agar aapke ghar pe parking hai, garage hai, and that garage houses an electric vehicle, the charging station which you will install in your garage will also be a part of the built environment, right? So that is called as built environment. Taken into consideration, you may have trees, you may have some veranda. If you have multi-floor, you may have some swimming pool or whatever it is. So that is called as the built environment. Now they say that they need to have either a positive or a negative effect on the natural environment, also on the people living in the building. That means not only on the environment, but also what is the effect on the occupant who's there inside the building has to be taken into consideration whenever you talk about green building. Now, if we look for the World Green Building Council's definition, they regard green building as a building that in the activities of design, construction, operation will reduce or eliminate any negative impact that can create and can create possibly positive impacts on the natural environment, right? That means a building which is eliminating or reducing any negative effects and striving towards creating a positive effect will be regarded as green building. Here, in this definition, there is no concept about occupants. Okay? Whereas in this definition, there is no concept on the construction, design or operation activity. Now let us come to the Environmental Protection Agency's US definition. They say that green building is the practice of creating structure and processes that are environmentally responsible and resource efficient throughout the complete life cycle of the building, starting from the siting design up till the renovation and deconstruction. This definition also does not include occupants, but it widens the range of the building's life cycle. If we come to if we look here, all these three definitions, no rocket science here. These are very simple definitions which we have been doing since civilizations. If you look in all these definitions, green building from USGBC, WGBC and US EPA, all of these definitions talk about only one thing: optimal usage of Jal, Vayu, Prithvi, Akash. Optimal usage of water, Vayu, air, Prithvi, soil, Akash, sky. Right? And this is where we can now have differentiation between a green building and an energy efficient building. Green building will talk about Jal, Vayu, Prithvi, Akash in order to take into consideration how resources are being used. That means it will talk about water energy, water conservation, energy efficiency or energy conservation, and it will also talk about the waste disposal, green buildings. Energy efficient buildings, on the other hand, the focus is only on the energy, majorly on the electricity usage. What are the activities from siting, designing of the building up till the deconstruction, and each and every activity, how much amount of electricity or energy is being used? Whereas for the same building, if you want to apply for green building certification, then you have to take into consideration energy, water, waste disposal, resource efficiency, all these things, right? So I hope now you have been able to differentiate between energy efficient building and green buildings. There are different ratings which are available here in India. One is the very famously known as GRIHA. It stands for Green Rating Integrated Habitat Assessment. It's a sensible based rating system. It was developed by Terry somewhere around 2000 and then adopted by Non-Conventional Energy Sources Department of Ministry of Power, which is right now MNRE. Then we have Indian Green Building Council. Then we have ASSOCHAM's GEM. ASSOCHAM stands for Associated Chamber of Commerce for India. Then we have LEED Rating. LEED Rating stands for Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. If you look all these ratings, why it is required is just a mathematical tool in order to assess the green performance of a building. This is an FDP, right? Just like how we faculties use marking scheme and quantify the performance of a student and how we can report it so that we can work on the COPO attainments and the outcome based education. So that's a mathematical tool, a rating system. Similarly, we have green building rating systems, right? Apart from this, which you are seeing about the green building rating systems, we also has codes. Codes. The National Building Code is necessary for any building which is constructed in India to satisfy. It comes up with the guidelines. And we have Energy Conservation Building Code, ECBC, 2000, started in 2007, right? Which talks about energy conservation. ECBC is only applicable for connected load of greater than 1200 kilowatt hour. That is for commercial buildings. But right now, the Bureau of Energy Efficiency has worked out on Eco Samhita, that is residential, that is a residential ECBC and industrial ECBC also. Open source, I would request all of you, if interested, you may go through it. And industrial ECBC, it talks majorly about the energy usage and hence the electricity consumption and how we can conserve that much amount of energy. Moving further, now that we have established green building, energy efficient building, now it's time that we look into the consideration of something called as smart grid. Why we require smart grid is because then we will come to our what we call as the definition for smart buildings. There are various definitions which are available for smart grid. Again, several definitions are available for the smart grid, but our focus will be on the standardized definitions which have been given by the reputed agencies, right? The figure which you are seeing on your screen is a smart grid conceptual model that is given by the National Institutes of Standards and Technology, which is a US-based institute. It has a conceptual model. It already had a conceptual model in 2008-2010. They updated that model, taken into consideration that there has to be, of course, there is generation, transmission, distribution, utilization or consumption, but all of this needs to be happening with an active stakeholder participation through electricity markets, operations and service providers, right? Matlab, who is providing the service? Service provider can be, for example, in India, we have POSOCO, Power System Corporation of India Limited, which is subsidiary of Power Grid Corporation of India Limited. When we talk about smart grid, we know that we will also have distribution system operator that may be a part of DISCOM, that is distribution company, or some third party based organization. Now, if we look into the standardized definitions, there are different definitions. European Technology Innovation Platform of Smart Networks define smart grids as a grid which has a salient features of low cost, security, intelligent integration, and sustainability. Low cost, security, intelligent integration, and sustainability. Whereas if we talk about the International Energy Agency, they say that not only sustainability and integration, you need to have ICT-based tools with active coordination of all the players which are involved in the development of the smart grid. All of this should happen at economically, that means at minimal cost. Minimal cost. So ETIP doesn't talk about cost. IEA talks about minimal cost with inclusion of ICT-based tools. If we talk about the definition of International Electrotechnical Commission, I am not reading out the definition, I am just giving you the salient features because that would be better. They talk about ICT, coordination, integration, each and everything, but they talk about optimal power flow. Optimal power flow is necessary. इंडिया में सिर्फ पावर फ्लो स्टडीज होता है, ऑप्टिमल पावर फ्लो नहीं होता है. दो वी हैव POSOCO हैज हैड सम क्रोर फंडिंग फ्रॉम वर्ल्ड बैंक एंड दे आर गेटिंग द सॉफ्टवेयर फ्रॉम NREL एंड ऑल्सो फ्रॉम देयर ओन लैबोरेटरीज ऑन ऑप्टिमल पावर फ्लो एंड देन दे विल बी वन और टू पायलट स्टडीज ऑन सिक्योरिटी कंस्ट्रेंट ऑप्टिमल पावर फ्लो. बट ऑप्टिमल पावर फ्लो इज ऑल्सो नेसेसरी. ऑप्टिमल पावर फ्लो इज नथिंग बट इकोनॉमिक लोड डिस्पैच, load frequency control with minimum environmental impact combined together is optimal power flow. Optimal power flow, IEC says, optimal power flow is not only necessary for transmission system, but is also necessary for the distribution system as well. Because there is a bidirectional flow of power, demand side measures, renewable energy generators connected to the primary and secondary distribution system. And also we have what we call it as electric vehicles, thermal energy storage, so on and so forth. So much voltage congestion problem can happen. So distributed based optimal power flow studies are necessary to be included if we talk about smart grid. If we talk about European Commission, they say that smart grid will always be a closed electrical network that has a capability of automatic monitoring, fully automatic monitoring of the power or all the parameters. Usually we have three phase currents, three phase voltages, frequency, any unbalance. Okay, unbalance is not a primary parameter. We work upon it through analysis, but not a primary parameter. Current, voltage, frequency, active power, reactive power, rate of change of frequency, ROCOF. But if you go to any of the POSOCO's web stations, they have a big computer installed in their control rooms, and you will have various continuous time signals as well if they have PMUs installed. If not, they would be working on the per unit values. Why I have taken all these four definitions is because combining all these definitions, we have a definition for Indian smart grid. The smart grid is defined through National Smart Grid Mission under Ministry of Power as an electrical power grid that has the capability of automation, communication, and IT systems in order to monitor the power flow from the generating plants up till the utilization level, even up till down to the appliance level. That is where this talk of grid interactive building energy system comes place. Our Indian smart grid will see what is happening right now. Right now, even if you have a smart meter installed or a digital meter installed, ek to digital meters ko smart meter karke media agency report karti hai. That is not true. Prepaid meters ko bhi as a smart meter report karti hai. That is also not true. If we talk about smart meters, for example, or any metering infrastructure right now which is happening, the distribution utility has the information up till the metering point. After that, if you have switched on AC or switched on a motor or a refrigerator or an oven or a dishwasher or anything, is not known to them. So they are not doing any intrusive load monitoring. But smart grid says, coming back to the definition again, that smart grid is an electrical power grid with has the capability of automation, communication, information technology system in order to monitor the power from the generating station up till the consumption level and also down to the appliance level, and control that power flow in order to match generation and demand in real time or near real time, right? That is the technical definition of smart grid coming from the Ministry of Power. Having understood what building is, green building is, energy efficient building is, smart building is, let us also address the elephant again and look upon the last definition, which is for the smart building. Again, there is no universally defined technical definitions whenever you talk about smart building. But if you go through the dictionary of Oxford Dictionary, the smart building is usually defined as a smart home, right? But if you go through the IEEE press book, Sinopoli defines smart building as a building that involves installation and use of advanced integrated building technology system. That means here ICT aa gaya, and these systems include building automation aa gaya jo smart grid definition mein tha, life safety jo green building ke definition mein tha, टेलीकम्युनिकेशन अगेन आईसीटी, यूजर सिस्टम स्मार्ट ग्रिड के डेफिनेशन में था कि एक्टिव स्टेक होल्डर पार्टिसिपेशन होना चाहिए, एंड फैसिलिटी मैनेजमेंट सिस्टम. दैट मीन्स स्मार्ट बिल्डिंग इज अ कॉन्सेप्ट दैट इज कमिंग फ्रॉम ग्रीन बिल्डिंग, एनर्जी एफिशियंट बिल्डिंग, स्मार्ट ग्रिड, ऑल ऑफ देम कमिंग टूगेदर, राइट? नाउ वी विल लुक इन टू द मेजर मेन कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ नेट जीरो एनर्जी बिल्डिंग्स. We will look for the technical definition again coming from the International Energy Agency, and then we look how we can achieve zero energy building. And this is what is my major research concept, that how do we interact zero energy building and a grid. It is imperative that we understand first what a building energy system, and then look for the grid interaction. If we talk about a net zero energy building, why I have written building campus and communities, because if you read different author books or study different reports, they may say zero energy campus, zero energy community, or zero energy portfolio, or anything. But if you look for the technical definition which has been given by the National Institute of Building Sciences, an energy efficient building or an energy efficient campus or community on a source energy basis, the actual annual delivered energy should be less than or equal to the on-site renewable exported energy. If such a thing happens, then you can regard that building as a zero energy building. Again, I repeat, a zero energy building is an energy efficient building. Matlab, every zero energy building is an energy efficient building. Okay. Where on source energy basis, the actual annual delivered energy is less than or equal to the on-site renewable exported energy. अगर आप सारे डेफिनेशंस देखोगे अभी तक जितने भी हमने कंसिडर किए हैं, दिस इज द ओनली डेफिनेशन विच टॉक्स अबाउट रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी इनसाइड इट, विच मेंशंस रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी, राइट? दैट्स व्हाई व्हेनेवर वी टॉक अबाउट जीरो एनर्जी बिल्डिंग, ऑलवेज रिमेंबर देयर हैज टू बी एन ऑन साइट रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी दैट नीड्स टू बी एक्सपोर्टेड, राइट? इन ऑर्डर टू डू दैट, अच्छा, एक्सपोर्टेड एनर्जी इज नथिंग बट दैट ऑन साइट रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी which is supplied through the site boundary, to the building site boundary, and used outside the site boundary, right? That is called as exported energy. कि ये मेरी boundary थी, ये मेरे दायरे थे, उस दायरे में जो बिजली का उत्पादन हुआ, उसके अलावा वो बिजली बाहर गई, उस boundary से बाहर गई, उस boundary से बाहर used हुई. For example, if I have a rooftop solar PV in a rural building, I charge my battery, go to the town, go to the market, install a switchboard which has 10 sockets, charge 1 rupee per hour for anyone who wants to charge their mobile phone through that socket. So that battery energy storage discharging power plus the power that has been lost from the site up till coming to the market will be the exported energy. Got it? Right. That means graphically, the energy usage per year should be balancing the energy generation per year. Now, if we analyze this definition and understand actually zero energy building and what exactly zero energy building is, first, let us look into what is source energy. What is source energy? Source energy is the site energy plus the energy consumed for attraction of that particular energy, processing and transport of primary fuel, the energy losses that can happen in the transmission and distribution. All of that accumulated together is the source energy. Okay, that is called as the source energy. Matlab, zero energy ke bare mein jab bhi definition ho, so you should not say that the total energy used technically. You always talk about the source energy. That means you always define zero energy on the basis of source energy, right? But not on the basis of building energy. If you refer European based books, they define building energy as site energy. One and the same ही है. Building energy or site energy is the same. On site of renewable energy is the renewable energy being generated which is coming out of your inverter or converter or the terminals which are coming out. Source energy is the site energy plus the energy being consumed in the processing of any fuel, right? Because on site renewable energy and on site energy generation are different. If you have diesel generator set as a backup, it's an on site energy generation, but it's not an on site renewable energy generation, right? There can be energy losses which are happening, and there can be energy losses in the conductor, so on and so forth. So that is source energy, right? Now it is also necessary that we look for this thing which is called as the boundary or site boundary, right? Site boundary is a line which you can see on your screen, the dashed line that marks the limit of the building site across which the delivered energy and exported energy can be calculated. Site boundary is the line that marks the limit of the building site across which the delivered energy and the exported energy can be calculated or measured. Right? Now, if we look into this definition, we see from this figure that there is some measurement that needs to happen. And where do we measure it? I will tell you. For example, whenever you talk about rooftop solar PV, a very interesting concept that comes is meter ko inverter se pehle lagana hai ya inverter ke baad mein lagana hai when you talk about microgrids. Inverter se pehle lagaya to wo inverter microgrid ki property hogi. Inverter ke baad lagaya to inverter wo ghar ki property hogi. So that is why it is very interesting and significant. Where is your point of measurement? The point of measurement will give you the point of calculation or the point of billing, right? This boundary only, let me say site boundary, will represent the meaningful boundary, that is the functionality part of the building, right? Agar ek building hai, to typically jo building ka site hai, which is the boundary over there, from there the meter which is coming out can be regarded as a site boundary. So it has a point of common coupling, which we famously called as PCC. Again, going through European standard, it's called as point of utility interface, PUI, one and the same. If you see the figure which you are seeing on your screen, this figure shows the site boundary of the energy and how it forms from the building energy, on-site renewable energy production, delivered energy and the exported energy, which you can see on your screen, right? So the dashed line will represent the boundary and the solid lines are representing the energy transfer or leaving the boundary used for zero energy accounting, right? So if we, I was talking about energy. So the yellow line will always, the yellow line here represents only for electricity. Electricity. Whereas the other lines are representing for space heating or cooling, right? Because they are also of energy in nature, but they are more of thermal energy in nature. So if I would say I am using Ohm's law for electrical energy, I will be using Newton's law of conduction for the thermal energy transfer and so on and so forth. Now, another thing that needs to be understand, that needs to be very interestingly see here, is a concept called as accounting. Energy accounting, whenever we talk about net zero energy building. See, a zero energy building, definition on your screen, usually or typically is a grid connected building, which is very energy efficient. So the premise is that the zero energy buildings use either power from the grid or other energy networks to transfer any surplus of on-site renewable energy to other users. So concept of peer-to-peer can come into the picture. Right? Now, when you talk about energy, I'm talking about global. Okay? If you talk about energy for a zero energy building, energy accounting would include the energy which is used for heating, for cooling, for ventilation, for domestic hot water, for lighting purpose, both indoor and outdoor, for pluggable loads, for processing energy, and for any transportation that can occur within the building premises. That means what we defined, building energy systems. Jo humne definition diya tha, building energy systems, all those systems will be taken into the consideration. Delivered energy mein kya aayega? Delivered energy to the building. See, they are to the building. Matlab building ko energy mil rahi hai. Delivered energy to the building will include electricity from the grid, any renewable power coming from it, that is on-site solar PV, which can be rooftop, which can be rooftop of your garage, which can be building integrated photovoltaic, anything. And non-renewable also. Why? The example just we gave, diesel generator sets, that is also being taken into consideration, right? a zero energy building will balance its energy use so that the exported energy to the grid or any other network इसलिए कह रहा हूँ क्योंकि हो सकता है कि वो किसी माइक्रोग्रिड को सर्व कर रहा है राइट और किसी कैंपस को सर्व कर रहा है या किसी फैसिलिटी को सर्व कर रहा है दैट यू हैव अ कैंपस यू हैव वन टॉल बिल्डिंग आउट ऑफ 10 बिल्डिंग्स यू हैव वन टॉल बिल्डिंग एंड यू कैन कॉल द टॉल बिल्डिंग अ जीरो एनर्जी बिल्डिंग विच विल सर्व द फीडर ऑफ योर कैंपस राइट सो व्हाट आई वाज सेइंग हां सो अ जीरो एनर्जी बिल्डिंग विल बैलेंस its energy use so that this exported energy which is being exported to the grid or other energy network is exactly equal to or greater than the delivered energy on an annual basis that means exported energy should be greater than equal to the energy delivered to the building on an annual basis then only we can say if that particular building is zero energy building or not okay Right now, while discussing, I came up with something. Let me also share that. Just a second. This is slide number 18, right? Okay. Now, let us understand what do we, how can we do the source energy calculations? See. Most building managers or most number of researchers are familiar with what is site energy. Site energy is the amount of energy consumed by the building as measured by the utility meter. That is our meter, right? जो हमारी meter की reading आएगी or technically called as site energy consumption will be useful for understanding the performance of the building and its system but it will not tell us the whole story of the impact from resource consumption and the emissions associated with that particular energy use right and also we will not be able to see from that meter reading if we are able to use efficiently or effectively our on-site renewable energy generation such as photovoltaic Therefore, in order to assess the relative efficiencies of buildings, it is necessary to convert all the types of energy into an equivalent raw fuel that it can be consumed in generating one unit of energy that is being used. Right? For that, we require a concept called as source energy. Again, I repeat, what happens is whenever we talk about zero energy building, lot of things is involved just look like a zero energy building like a distribution system itself it has electric wiring different voltage levels different loads not a ring min network not a closed loop network it can have electric vehicle it can have battery energy storage thermal energy storage diesel generator set building integrated pv rooftop solar pv If it is a high tower building and swimming pool is on the top, then a pump storage hydro turbine can also be there, right? So large number of things are available. Each and everything which I have just said will have some efficiency. Efficiency means, उसका input fuel क्या है और वो output क्या दे रहा है? चाहे वो pumped hydro storage हो, चाहे battery energy storage हो, चाहे rooftop solar PV हो, या फिर particularly कोई demand response based load हो, smart ACs or anything, right? In order to assess relative efficiencies of buildings with varying fuel types, we will convert these types of energy into an equivalent unit. Or what will be that equivalent unit? Ki raw fuel kitna consume hua in generating one unit of energy consumed on the site. कितना मेरा फ्यूल लगा वन यूनिट ऑफ एनर्जी जनरेट करने के लिए, जो तुरंत मेरा साइट कंज्यूम कर देता है, मेरा बिल्डिंग कंज्यूम कर देता है. दैट इज व्हाट इज द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ सोर्स एनर्जी. दैट इज व्हाट इज द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ सोर्स एनर्जी. विदाउट अंडरस्टैंडिंग सोर्स एनर्जी वन कैन नॉट अंडरस्टैंड अ जीरो एनर्जी बिल्डिंग. Whenever energy is consumed on site, the conversion of source energy must account for the energy consumed in the extraction, energy consumed in the extraction, processing, transporting fuels, primary fuels, right? Also takes into consideration the energy losses that can happen in combined heat power plant, so that will be a thermal energy loss and can happen in transmission and distribution to the building site. That are T&D losses, right? Now every country has a national what you call it as conversion to source energy technique. Conversion to source energy factor. Technique remains the same. Factors differ. Right? What is being done is, source energy is calculated from the figure that we have seen, ki delivered energy and export energy, by using some source energy conversion factors. Right? That means the source energy mathematically can be defined as, if we see here, we have delivered an energy and exported energy. For each and every system, up till one, up till capital N, for N subsystems, right? For every subsystem, there will be some energy type. How much amount of energy is being delivered by that particular fuel type into the source energy conversion factor, into the source energy conversion factor of that particular type, right? This is the delivered energy minus how much amount of energy is being exported for that same particular fuel type into what is the energy conversion factor for that exported energy for that particular fuel type, right? This will give me the source energy. If the source energy is less than equal to zero, then I will say that that particular building, let me say Rth building, is a zero energy building. Right? Then only I will be able to say that that particular building is a zero energy building. If you look into the definition was that only, right? That the exported energy should be greater than the delivered energy. And that's what has been happened here. Right? So this is how we work upon the zero energy building. Now I hope I have in detail why I have deep down into zero energy building is because I did not see any session on zero energy building. So I thought that it is important for you to understand what zero energy building is actually, because sub mathematics, yeah, it's coming from research of different books and papers. It's not from the single source, but it's very interesting to see that. Now let us now understand how does a building achieve a net zero energy status. Okay, we have now understood that, okay, the source energy, the source energy should be less than equal to zero, so that we can say that that particular building is a zero energy building. But how does a building achieve net zero energy? Either two things. Either you construct a new net zero energy building, or you convert a old zero energy building into a net zero energy building. That can be through reconstruction, retrofit, and deconstruction. In order to do both the things, there are several conditions that need to be taken into consideration. The very first one is location. Where is your building? What is the latitude, longitude? What are the climatic circles? What is the building's exposure? All of this will have an effect, right? What are the wind patterns, temperature, rain patterns, so on and so forth. Second factor is orientation. The orientation of the building depends upon the success of achieving net zero energy. Parameters such as renewable energy generation mechanism for solar PVs, they work best when the building is facing south, right? Usually, if we talk about the architects, right? When the building is facing south, and then you have if any shade is available or not, so that you can use less air conditioner loads. Is there any natural lighting or not? Because they account for more than around one fourth of the total energy consumption, as we have seen from the previous slides. Right? So can you have an orientation of a building in such a way that natural lighting reduces your load? Then natural breeze. Natural breeze means you can have a window arrangement. It is an architectural concept, a window arrangement or use of skylights so that you will have a natural breeze so that a passive cooling can happen. Then you have some design-based strategies. One has to make sure that you have the best insulating material possible so the building conserves as much as energy as possible. They need to conserve energy. Windows can be dual pane, triple pane, and maybe sealed. And they pose a very major factor whenever we talk about the conserving energy. There can be some passive strategies also whenever we talk about building design, that is maximizing energy performance, minimizing energy usage, right? We may have high efficient appliances, low energy HVAC systems, tight air sealing, very better insulation to provide an extra barrier between the interior and exterior of the building, and a very good ventilation, right? All of this can be taken into consideration. Right, and this comes through an architectural design. Usually, ASHRAE has standards for it, American Society Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers. Right, and ASHRAE standard, I think 154 or something, it talks about all these design strategies. Then we have renewable and active strategies. Because we are talking about achieving net zero energy. In the definition, there is nowhere written that on-site energy should be renewable. But from now, from our understanding, our intuition, we will always look towards or encourage ourselves towards more usage of the renewable energy generator, right? So it is imperative that depending upon all these things, location, orientation, and design, we should know if we want to have building integrated PV, solar rooftop PV, or garage-based PV, or pumped hydro storage, or small wind turbines, or a biomass-based gasifier plant, whatever it is, right? If the building is industrial scale, you can use a small wind also. It's not a problem, right? And you may also, if it's a campus, you may also use parabolic solar troughs that are converting solar thermal electricity. Solar thermal power, steam turbine, heat exchanger, steam turbine to electric generator, right? Now, the net zero energy buildings, they react in various ways. And they act and they try to interact with the electricity power grid in a various way. Hence, it is imperative to understand how the zero energy buildings and the grid interact with each other. See, energy moves between the grid and the conventional energy buildings in a single direction. I'm talking about conventional energy buildings. It flows from the grid. It flows from the grid to the building, utilizing the conventional metering. Utilizing the conventional metering. Right? If you say that, okay, you are not yet achieved zero energy building, but you have demand response based applications or appliances. Such buildings are called as moderately responsive buildings. They will have an interactive demand response with the building, with the grid. Buildings that are fully integrated with the grid will include some passive efficiency features as well as renewable energy production on site. That means you will have two types of interaction with the grid. One is the renewable energy oriented interaction, and the other one can be efficiency or demand side measure oriented interaction. Right? Both interactions are different, very easy. This talks about generation, supply side. This talks about demand side. Simple. Not a very complex thing. Right? So you know that if you have rooftop solar PV connected to a distribution line feeder, they all then, and also you have different type of things, then you know that if this is a substation, gets can be connected towards the electric power system. For analysis part, I will have this as my point of common coupling. So I can say this as my boundary for zero energy microgrid. And if I achieve each and every zero energy building, I can work towards development of a centralized peer-to-peer station that will communicate to each and every household. And then dictate how the power has to flow from one building to another building. Right? So these are the different interactions which can happen. If we look on to the figure of the right side, which is coming from the US Department of Energy's report, they say that deep down, if we talk about the grid interactive building energy systems, you need to develop something called as a building automation system. The building automation system will be interacting with the smart meter which is installed, and that smart meter will be having the communication and the pricing signal with the electrical power system. And if you go to the building, you will have a rooftop solar PV, HVAC system, lighting system, pluggable loads, sensors for sensing occupants, dynamic windows for design strategies, built environment electric vehicles, battery energy storage, thermal energy storage. Taking all of this into consideration, you will work upon the building automation system, which will do all the control algorithms in order to enable the power being flown from here to at what price, at what time, and at what magnitude, so that all the parameters, current, voltage, real power, reactive power, frequency, rate of change of frequency, can be taken into consideration. Okay, all right. Are you able to see the screen? Is the screen visible, sir? मेरे टैब में अलग सारा. Is it visible? Okay, okay. Sorry.
Yes, sir.
I don't want subtitle. Chalo, nevertheless, some new setting has come up. Chalo. Now, if you look, the graphic which I am presenting on the screen talks about the grid interactive building energy systems. Whatever we have understood up till now, we can see that whenever there is a concept that, okay, you have developed a zero energy building, you have developed a zero energy building, and now you need to understand or you need to analyze. You need to understand or you need to analyze how you can proliferate the distributed generation in order to create an active or a distribution system automation. In order to do that, buildings, majorly zero energy buildings, can come into the picture, right? Here, buildings for this concept of grid interaction building energy system will be regarded something like grid citizen. It's a new concept which is coming up. Grid citizen is a building that, grid citizen is a zero energy building that will assist the electrical power grid in order to manage stability and also in order to have positive active power regulation and reactive power control, right? So not only zero energy building, and as the definition says, zero energy building is an energy efficient building. So agar ek zero energy building hai, toh it has to be energy efficient building, right? So if a zero energy building is there, it will be good grid citizen only if that zero energy building is assisting the electrical power grid, right? Majorly for the grid stability. That is what we will see here. In order to do that, it is imperative that we first understand the modeling and simulation of the building energy systems. They are very complex and we have to develop computer-based algorithms. So we need to reduce the model order. We then develop the HVAC system model and we will look from some optimization algorithms and look for the some simulation results over there. In order to work for the grid interactive building energy systems, the very first step one is the building energy modeling, because in every development of any energy control strategy, it is imperative that we have a good precise models. Then we have to simulate that building energy model under different time periods and different occupancy patterns. Then we can work for stability and controllability assessment and then implementation evaluation designation analysis. No. There is one mistake here. There is a small mistake over here. So what I will do is I will type it down so that it becomes your update here. Building energy modeling and simulation becomes your first step. The second step involves comfort and energy optimization, or we can write it as occupancy driven comfort and energy optimization. That means you are taking into consideration the occupants as well. I'll run down this, right? The third step will be your grid interaction modeling. you will be modeling your electrical power grid or the grid interaction modeling. So now the stepwise procedure is actually, first is building energy modeling and simulation, then is your occupancy driven comfort and energy optimization and grid interaction modeling. After that, implementation, evaluation and FDD. FDD stands for fault detection and diagnosis. For building energy modeling and simulation, it is imperative that we understand that there are different types of models: white box, black box and gray box models. White box models means we know everything about the system. It is completely transparent. It is white. We just give the input, we get the output. Black box modeling means we don't know anything about the system. It is like a black box. We give certain experimental inputs, develop output-input relationship. Those mathematical relationships are my modeling equations. Then we have gray box modeling. Gray box modeling means I know the modeling structure or accuracy, but I need to understand or know the values of the parameters. For that, I will be conducting experiments through per parameter identification. So it is a mixture of white box model and black box model. White box models are very accurate, are perfectly accurate. They are benchmark for accuracy, but they are computationally burdened. They are very heavy. Black box models are simple models, but they suffer from accuracy. Gray box modeling is a trade-off between them. You can use different simulation programs which are available, usually Energy Plus, Open Source, eQuest, ESPR, Transys, and Department of Energies. These are the different modeling characteristics that can be taken into consideration whenever you do for building energy modeling and simulation. These are certain parameters which are used in building energy modeling. Depending upon your target of control strategy you want to develop, you can have uncontrollable or controllable parameter. Uncontrollable parameter means my control strategy will not be able to affect its behavior over time. Those are uncontrollable. They can be applied for residential or non-residential. NR stands for non-residential, R stands for residential. This is the thermal electrical analogy which we use. For every electrical system, we have an equivalent electrical network circuit. Similarly, for every thermal energy transfer process, we have an electrical equivalent circuit. Analogy being, thermal energy flows or heat flows from a higher temperature point to a lower temperature point. Similarly, electric current flows from a higher potential point to a lower potential point. For every element, if you look around you while watching this webinar, you may see that geometrically you are sitting inside a cuboid. You have four walls surrounding you. You have a floor and you have a roof, ceiling and you have a floor. You may have windows, you may have opening and closing of the doors and everything, but geometrically I'm saying. Each and every wall or the ceiling and the floor will have some thermophysical property. That means thickness, density, thermal conductivity. These are thermophysical properties. Each and every thermophysical property can be accounted for in order to calculate your thermal resistance and thermal capacitance. So your particular wall, every wall will have thermal resistance and thermal capacitance. And what are and they are calculated using this formula, textbook based formula, using these thermophysical properties: thickness, conductivity, density, thermal capacity. Okay. Now we will develop that model as an RC network, a second order RC network, because we all know the advantages of second order RC network. Why these are second orders? Because we have two ordinary differential equations, two ODEs, and we can take the Laplace transform. Like this can be RS and this can be 1 by SC. As I told you, we have developed a gray box modeling, so I need to know the parameter values of R1, R2, R3, C1, C2. I know that each and every wall, means what I'm trying to tell you is each and every wall will be modeled as a 3 resistance, 2 capacitance network. Now the task is, what should be that resistance and capacitance value? I know that all resistances added together should be equal to the thermal capacitance of the wall, all capacitances added together should be equal to the thermal capacitance of the borer. And how we will calculate thermal capacitance? From this formula. How we'll get this formula? From these values which are available from the manufacturer. Right? So we have to find out x1, x2, x3, y1, y2. Right? Because when this is true, that means each and every resistance is actually a fraction of the thermal resistance. This becomes my reduced order modeling through an optimization technique where I will develop a white box model for a wall. This is my white box model. Give a certain input, test input. It can be step, impulse or ramp or sinusoidal. Same input I will give here. Have guess values of all these things. Get the output which will be erroneous. Here output will be perfectly okay. I will take the error between these two outputs, sum squared error, will be minimizing those errors through these constraints. For this, we got an applied energy paper. This is the flowchart that is being used here. So the physical geometric construction gets reduced to a, each and every box here is a three resistance and two capacitance network. To avoid, for simplicity, I have written it like this. Okay. Now we will have a HVAC system model. I have taken an all seasonal HVAC system model from the ASHRAE textbook. And each and everything, the base model itself is a PID controlled based system. Now, if you look for the simulation results, as we do for IEEE bus systems, we have ASHRAE test cases. I have taken ASHRAE test cases and these are the parameters for it. For the simulation results, this is the state space analysis state matrices, as we have used the state space networks. What has happened? Just a second, please. I think, is the screen visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Just, how much time have I been left with?
10 minutes.
Is the screen visible now?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Okay, fine. So these are the transfer functions that we obtained. Performance characteristics which we do for each and every response that has been taken. As you can see, the rise time or settling time in hours. So that means we require a model order reduction technique. And through the model order reduction technique only, which we got it in terms of your few hours only. Now, these are the simulation results that we have developed. We didn't have adequate funds to do experimental results. So I have taken this from the weather data of Dehradun. And these are the output of my building model. That is the building space air temperature, which will affect HVAC system. And also relative humidity, which will affect my HVAC system, which is the heating, ventilation and air conditioning system. This is the intelligent energy control and comfort optimization, because as all the definitions say, the inhabitants inside the building should also be taken into consideration. In order to do that, we need to take into consideration the performance results as well. And that is what is being done here. That is what is being done here. It becomes a multi-objective optimization problem where you want to maximize the comfort, right? That depends upon the temperature, illumination level, CO2 concentration in parts per million. Why I have taken only these two parameters is because we have sensors available in the market which will sense all these parameters. Minimization of energy. As we have said, we have taken only two systems in our building energy system, HVAC and lighting system. Maximization of comfort becomes minimization of discomfort. So there are two minimization functions, minimization of energy, minimization of discomfort. This is the Pareto front, which is being achieved as a non-dominated. We will multi-objective optimization never has a single solution. There are pool of solutions. From that, we have taken one best sample solutions, as you can see, for 98% comfort till 94% of comfort. These are the simulation results. With PID based control result, my response is like this, right? For a standard reference input, whereas with multi-objective optimization, my response is much better. Same thing goes for your building space CO2 concentration, illumination level, and also with overall occupant comfort. This is the energy performance, energy savings achieved for HVAC system for different simulation period of time, lighting systems for different simulation period of time, total energy for different simulation period of time. Now, the third step was the grid interaction modeling. It is now imperative that we understand how do we model the interaction of the grid. In order to do that, we need to understand that we will be developing an optimal control problem. This will be developed as an optimal control problem, and it is imperative that we develop it as a what we call it as a network, right? So what we have done is, in order to have the dynamics, we will take the swing equation analysis for a particular bus system, and if for that bus the generators are not connected, that means that is not a zero energy building, so we will not have the LHS. The LHS will be equal to zero. The PGK will be talking about the electric power that will be taken from the grid. The buildings which will be loaded will be affecting this PLK. This is where your building load or the meters which are connected, which we discussed in the definition of zero energy building, will be connected over here, right? And then we can do the state space analysis. Through the state space analysis, we achieve different results for the simulations systems, right? Actually, let me just tell you how the PLK is. All of us know swing equation, which we have studied in our in our undergraduate study in power system stability. And what the PLK will be: the power load connected to the bus K will be nothing but the power of HVAC systems connected as load aggregated for all the buildings connected through it. Similarly, for all the buildings connected to it, and this will be time based, power lighting for the time minus all the buildings where you will have the power being generated from the exported energy in time t. That will be dictating our PLK. And the beauty of this equation is, even if the PLK becomes negative, this becomes positive, I can do frequency regulation because my delta values will change. Delta values will regulate the active power that is being transferred, because active power will transfer from a higher delta point to the lower delta point, right? So we can say it can be a uncontrollable and controllable load at that particular bus K. These are the simulation results which we can see here. The left side graph which you are seeing here, we did a test result on a 10 bus system. This is again under review. We did a bus, and you can see here that through different approaches, then we did develop an optimal control problem as a model-based predictive control, where we had a baseline scenario and we converted what we call it as, we calculated the error for the energy saving, right? Now, if you will see here, we calculated the energy savings per day comparing to the what we call it as baseline scenarios, right? Now, if you see here, we had a rolling window of around 5 minutes for MPC horizon, right? And we regulated the grid frequency around the normalization rate of 50 hertz, right? We took around 150 buildings into consideration, and the maximum peak was around maximum peak was around 400 to I think 450 kilowatt. 400 to 450 kilowatt was the building peak for each individual building, and they will be simulated. And there were 9 grid buses. For each 5 minute building simulation step, we use Sumtain method to discretize the swing equation into 10 seconds for the operation of the buses, right? So that become a 5 minute rolling program. It is very, if you can do it one on the your notebook, you can then come to with a option form where you will be using a quad probe command in the MATLAB, and you can develop these results. What you are seeing here are the bus angles. The bus one is the reference bus. Bus one is the reference bus. Here again, the bus one is the reference bus, and this that's why you are getting the distributed power from the buses. And this, the what you call the graph which you are seeing on your screen is for the stabilized, left side is the for the stabilized bus angles, and this is for the distributed power from the buses. Distributed power from the buses is what you call it as in per unit. If you see from the figure of this stabilized buses angle, you can say that the buses angles are stabilized very quickly, right? Now they are reaching the desired set points of power distribution by we can do that by examining the trajectories of it. By examining their trajectories, how they are being able to do it for the power supply in terms of per unit system, and that what is being done here. A per unit system will express any quantity as a fraction of the defined base quantity. Here we have taken the base value as 100. And then came up with the per unit system. As you can see, the first three buses operation trajectories are being shown here in the figure. There are certain up and down ramps at beginning seconds, but that is only for a few seconds. And then the buses get stabilized quickly to reach the values, right? But what I am trying to say is that we are able to achieve the 50 hertz stabilization factor. So this is how the architecture wise the grid interactive building energy system can look like. Architecture wise the grid interaction building energy system. And you can see here that you have different what we call it as processes, and also the physical things that can be taken into consideration, even for storage, rooftop solar PV, inverter load, smart loads, so on and so forth. So this is what in future scope I would like to work on, that is develop a tool to evaluate the socio-techno-economic analysis of a prosumer-based building energy systems and assess the energy effects and the environmental effects as well. These are certain references. Thank you so very much for your patient listening, and I'm open for any questions which you may have. Thank you so very much, sir.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Harish sir, for your wonderful lecture. And you nicely touch upon various points like building energy consumption and how it is growing with the trend, with the statistical data. And you give a more clarity on net zero energy building and the related terminology. And you also covered basic definition according to the standard, like green building, smart grid, and etc. Okay, and what are the parameters that one must take into consideration for achieving net zero building, net zero energy building, that also we have discussed. And later, in the later you covered grid interaction with the zero energy building through the modeling and simulation. We are very thankful to you, sir. And let me keep this Thank session you, open for participants for the question answer session. So, yes. Now this session is open for the participants. Please, anyone would you like to ask anything? You just unmute your mic, participant, please.
I have one question. Is it possible to have net zero building cluster in a cramped city space when there are clusters of multi-storey building.
Sorry, sir, come again. Sir, sorry, can you be a bit louder, sir?
Is it possible to have net zero building, energy building in a cramped city space?
Yes, yes, through aggregators. Yes, it is being worked upon, sir. Yes. As a cluster of buildings, so that why it is being there, sir? Because then we will not be arresting ourselves to have all the buildings close to the geographic locations. If we can have a virtual aggregator where through appropriate connections, the power gets accumulated over there, maybe a centralized base storage, and then can be connected for through the grid or through any other microgrid. It is coming up as a smart city concept, sir. It can be worked upon. I have seen few papers.
But if the space is very low, in a cramped
space is, sorry sir, space is
very low in a particular geographical location, there are too many tall buildings, so there is no scope for natural lighting or natural breeze. Then what happens?
Just a second, sir. I'm so very sorry. I don't know why, but my volume is up, so I will just plug in my earphones. Yeah, sir, can you please repeat?
If there are cluster of tall buildings in a small space in a city, is it possible to have net zero building, energy building?
You're talking about only for that building, sir?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, it is possible, sir. It is possible. That is where how the retrofit analysis is coming.
Okay.
It is not, again, sir, I would repeat, it is a high misconception that only new buildings will be net zero energy buildings. Already existing building of any architecture or orientation has the potential, but it all depends upon having a very strong energy audit. Energy audit, sir, due to time limitations, I did not discuss, but that is also important.
Okay, any other participant, please?
Yeah.
Sir, may I ask?
Yes, yes, sir, please.
Yeah. Hello. Yeah.
Yes, you are audible, sir. But sir, continue, please.
Hello. Sir, basically you have preferred to go with the PID controller. So in most of case, it has been observed that while using PID controller, it will gives you the delay response.
Usually using PID controllers, our major focus has been on PI controllers.
Okay. Sir, is it the same approach Nicholas Jagras we supposed to carried out for to find out KI and KP?
No, sir. My focus was never on tuning of the PID controller because that is a baseline scenario. So I took a research paper of Nature Energy where they have given KP, TI and TD and I have taken those values because wo mera baseline.
Okay. Sir, that baseline that we supposed to vary with the momentum also or that kind of base load also. Suppose if I am designing for a 100 kilowatt and if I am designing for 10 kilowatt, does it seems to vary or that will remain same?
Sir, even that, yeah, I got your question, but that load variation is beyond the scope of my work, sir, because that load variation is when I am varying HVAC system, okay. But I did not vary HVAC system. So my system remained constant. Okay. For that particular system, we develop a strategy. And what we did in that applied energy paper is we simulated it because all of us know that without having hardware results, it is very difficult to get a good research paper. So what we did was we applied it to a low thermal capacity building, medium thermal capacity building, high thermal capacity building for a variation. Okay. Like for example, physically we can relate it as if I am the person, my HVAC system capacity may be the same, but if I go to a gym, okay, my requirement will be different as compared to me only going to a library.
Okay.
Both will have centralized air conditioning, but due to the nature of activity, the requirement will be more.
Okay.
So that is what I have taken.
Sir, basically, I would like to congratulate you regarding your simulation work because if we go and simulate, then it is precise modeling is required to carry out, and then after good publication can be published, and you have thrown many knowledgeable lights on such kind of things for modeling and simulation. So from bottom of my heart, I would like to thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Thank you.
Any other question from participant?
Hello, Harish sir.
Yes, sir. Continue, sir.
Sir.
Yeah, Dikshit Pathak. Hello. Hello, sir.
Hello, sir. Good evening. Kaise ho, sir?
Yeah. Badi. How are you?
Fine, sir. Fine.
Okay. So just a basic difference between like normal building and zero energy net building. So just we can, simplify manner. We can explain to the students. So any how building, just compare it.
Sir, that two type of differences can be, two type of representation can be shown. The slide that I have shown, the definition of zero energy building will itself give the difference between a normal building and a zero energy building. A normal building will always have that E source energy greater than zero. A net zero energy building or a zero energy building will always have that E source less than equal to zero. Source energy less than equal to zero.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, any other participant? Hello.
No, sir, you can conclude. Very nice.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, Harish, sir, for giving
Hello?
Time.
Thank you.
Sir, I would like to request you that if you share a PPT by watermarking yourself, so it won't be used as somewhere else.
Watermark, nahi, sir, abuse kar sakte ho, usko koi hai nahi. Sab open source material hi dala maine, ya published material.
Okay, sir, so that will be useful for us also to carry out further research.
Okay, sir.
All the PPTs of all the session will be shared with the participants. Don't worry about that. Okay.
I have a meeting now. If any participant have any questions, yes. I'll be more than happy to address them via email.
Yes, sir. Please conclude. Jugnu, sir, Professor Jugnu, please conclude because I got a response earlier. So before so many time because he is busy right now with VC meeting. So please conclude the session. Yes.
Definitely, sir. Thank you, sir, for on behalf of the organizing committee. Once again, I thank you for giving time to this session. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Good evening.
Thank you, Dr. Harish. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks to you, sir, for giving me the opportunity. Thank you to the department, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Sir, shall we leave?
Yes, definitely. You can leave, sir.